Welcome to Shaking the Foundations 2014. My name is Ruha Nagra, and I am one of the co-chairs of this year's conference, along with Heather Kriska and Ginny Halden. Tonight's keynote event was co-sponsored by the Stanford Program in African and African American Studies, and we'd like to thank the program so much for supporting the event and collaborating with us. I'd like to talk very briefly about Shaking the Foundations before turning it over to Ginny. You probably know Shaking the Foundations as the two-day progressive lawyering conference that features panels and workshops on a range of topics from immigration to mass incarceration to food justice to LGBTQ rights to international human rights. You should certainly check out our conference schedule, plan to attend the events that interest you, and connect with attorneys, law students, community organizers, and others whose careers and lives are anchored in a vision of social justice. But this conference strives to be more than just the sum of its parts. Above all, we seek to cultivate a deep and abiding solidarity across struggles. In this vein, two recent events come to mind. This past summer saw first the massacre of over 2,100 Palestinians in the Gaza Strip, and then the gunning down of yet another unarmed black teenager in Ferguson, Missouri. As the streets of Ferguson, filled with tear gas and heavily armed SWAT teams moving in to crush protests, some protesters began chanting, "Gaza Strip," as they faced the lines of police. "We're being occupied," one protester commented to a reporter. "Will we as a people rise up like the people of Gaza?" Meanwhile, Palestinians in the West Bank began tweeting advice to Ferguson protesters on how to deal with tear gas and other riot control tactics. "Don't keep much distance from the police. If you're close to them, they can't tear gas." To hashtag Ferguson from hashtag Palestine, tweeted one. "Always make sure to run against the wind, to keep calm when you're tear gassed. The pain will pass. Don't rub your eyes. Don't use water. Instead, use milk or Coke. Hashtag Ferguson solidarity," tweeted others. These expressions of cross-struggle solidarity were grounded in material connections. At least two of the four law enforcement agencies that were deployed in Ferguson received training from Israeli security forces in recent years. The same U.S. corporation, Combined Tactical Systems, supplied both the St. Louis police and the Israeli military with tear gas and other riot control gear. Expressions of solidarity from Ferguson to Palestine and vice versa were also grounded in experiential connections. Shared experiences of police brutality, mass incarceration, and dispossession. Ferguson was fueled in part by the razing of a historic black town to accommodate a runway that was ultimately never built. So this is what Shaking the Foundations is all about: the imperative to organize for justice everywhere, the recognition that our struggles are intimately connected, both materially and experientially, the conviction that just as our oppressors collaborate and coordinate, so must we. Thank you.
She's worked at the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights in Boston and San Francisco, at Protection Advocacy Inc. as a housing discrimination attorney at the Office of Civil Complaints for the San Francisco Police Commission. And in addition to her incredible civil rights work, Diane is really the backbone of the public interest community here at Stanford. She is a mentor to me and countless other law students and public interest attorneys. And finally, I just want to say that Diane's support for this conference has been indispensable to the board, and we can't thank her enough.
My compliments to really all of you who organized this conference. Congratulations on the successful event. Good evening, everyone, and on behalf of the law school, welcome to Stanford. I want to thank all of you who are in the audience, who participated in panels today, who networked with our students and other students here. We can't thank you enough for your generosity. I am enormously honored to be able to provide an introduction of Michelle Alexander. A little known fact is that I probably actually wouldn't be here at Stanford if it weren't for Michelle. She was a main attraction when I contemplated leaving practice to come to Stanford to build its public interest program. I didn't know Michelle very well at that point, actually, in the early 2000s, but we had interacted for our civil rights work, or occasionally through seeing each other in our local neighborhood near Lake Merritt in Oakland. The first time that I actually met Michelle Alexander, instead of just seeing Michelle, she was speaking about a campaign that she was launching at the ACLU before a statewide commission. She was describing this campaign that challenged the criminalization of driving, at least if you were black or brown, the DWB campaign. I was working on issues related to the profiling and federal prosecution of Dr. Wendell Lee. I heard Michelle speak and was instantly impressed by the way she captured the commission's attention by describing the deep social ramifications of law enforcement overreach into communities of color and especially the black community. I became a fan then, even following her in a certain kind of way here to Stanford. And though she soon left me here, I remain a fan to this day. I think that for many of us across multiple generations and across communities, when Michelle Alexander's book, The New Jim Crow, Mass Incarceration in the Age of Colorblindness, was published, there was a moment, capital A, capital M, an aha moment, a collective, vociferous, naughty moment, a thank goodness she said that and wrote this moment. Because Michelle had written this earth-shattering, groundbreaking book about, well, the most mundane. It's not quite the right word, and I don't mean it in the sense of dull or boring, but in the sense that what she describes is something that most folks had just started to take for granted. In the sense that what she describes has been all around us, all the time, all of our lives. And while Michelle's work might feel particularly timely now, with the nation's attention on Ferguson, Missouri, and the killing of Michael Brown, it is unfortunately timeless for any given day of any given year, for any given black man or community in America. That is what Michelle has documented, analyzed, and articulated, the wrongness of. For us in one of the most important books, I think, of my lifetime and of yours. Ralph Ellison wrote in one of his essays, "Our task then always is to challenge the apparent forms of reality, that is the fixed manner and values of the few, and to struggle with it until it reveals its mad, very implicated chaos, its false faiths, and so on, until it surrenders its insight, its truth." That is the work that Michelle Alexander has done. As many of my students know, I use Michelle's book in my teaching, and it touches students profoundly. Some students have asked me why I teach anything else, why anybody really ever does teach anything else. Students have told me that this book has awakened them from a deep slumber and changed the course of their lives. Some students have apparently made entire branches of their family read it. And when I use Michelle's book in my teaching, there are sometimes tears, sometimes they're mine. There is sometimes denial, but much, much more frequently, there is resolve, there is anger. There is a feeling of a call to address what she brilliantly documents and asks us to no longer treat as mundane, to no longer accept as simply the fabric of our American life. Now, Michelle has accomplished much. She's a graduate of Vanderbilt and this law school, where she directed a civil rights clinic. She clerked on the U.S. Supreme Court, following one with the D.C. Circuit. And prior to full-time teaching and writing, Michelle was an attorney with a private public interest civil rights firm in Oakland and the head of the Racial Justice Project at the ACLU of Northern California. But the stars aligned, and in 2005, she won a Soros Justice Fellowship that supported her ability to write this amazing book. And that same year, she left me, and she went to accept a joint appointment at Ohio State's University's Pierwant Institute for the Study of Race and Ethnicity and the Moritz College of Law. Michelle has been, as you know, featured in national and local media and has received many, many well-deserved accolades and awards. But I was thinking, if I had an award to name and to give to Michelle Alexander, it would be the Wayfinding Award. Now, until recently, I had never really been exposed to architecture, building design, interior design. Recently, I sat on a committee that had marginal input into the redesign of a floor at the law school for our research center. And in a research project now, I work with colleagues and students as we assess the accessibility of courthouses for limited English proficient court youth in California. It is through these experiences that I have heard the word wayfinding time and again. And the idea is of using lights or signage or pathways to improve the wayfinding within a building, to summon people along certain routes. What Michelle has accomplished in all of her work, not just the book for which most know her, is to shine a light on parts of our society many wish would remain shrouded in some dark corner, to write in large, bold letters that are very hard to ignore about the systems that we have created and that we, each one of us, sustain and that must be torn down if we are ever to achieve any measure of fairness in this society. And with her own 2 feet, she has trodden ground to lay the paths so that we can find them and find a different way. Thank you, Michelle. I give you the Wayfinding Award. Please join me in welcoming her.
Diane, I'm just so glad to be here, surrounded by so many people of conscience committed to justice, not just in theory, but in practice, in daily life. My own passion for social justice, using law as a tool for social change, was born right here at Stanford Law School when I was a student quite a long time ago. Back in the 90s, I was part of a program called Lawyering for Social Change here at Stanford Law School. That program inspired me beyond measure, set me on the course of committing my life to using whatever skills, talents, abilities, privileges that I had gained as a lawyer to work for a bold, creative, ever-expanding vision of justice. The Lawyering for Social Change program no longer exists here at Stanford Law School. It was dismantled because many faculty members felt threatened by it. It was said that the Lawyering for Social Change curriculum was too radical, too political, as though there were some politically neutral way to teach about law and justice. The entire law school curriculum back then could have been entitled Lawyering for the Status Quo. The textbooks contain nothing but legal opinions stripped of all of the essential facts that might allow a student to determine whether anything like justice was actually being done. Details like race, class, social and political context, historical background, the desires and goals and aims of the people involved, the litigants, how they felt about the resolution of their cases or conflicts. All of that was stripped away. We were told that we were being taught to think like lawyers and engage in issue spotting. But all of the most important issues, the truly relevant issues, it seemed, were routinely excluded from our readings and silenced in class discussions. The Lawyering for Social Change curriculum aimed to resist the dehumanizing effect of legal education and help us to think not like lawyers, but like human beings who cared for other human beings and who hoped to use law and legal skills in partnership with people, families, communities, in the pursuit of justice. Justice, that concept that necessarily must evolve and change with the times and differing social context. A concept that must continually be interrogated and challenged. Professor Jerry Lopez, back then, was one of my favorite professors, and he used to say that law school is a lot like a sausage factory. All these beautiful, vibrant creatures come in, young, aspiring students with ideals and dreams of doing good in the world. And here in law school, they easily get ground up, stuffed into little sausage casings. These casings being brand new suits and freshly shined shoes. And they go out of this place on a conveyor belt, headed to big corporate law firms, not so vibrant anymore, now just pre-packaged items destined for little more than giving the world a bad case of gas. And I used to laugh when Jerry would joke like that. It was only years after I graduated that I realized how right he was. I myself clerked for a couple of years and then went off to a big fancy firm in Washington, D.C. Tempted by the salary, I wanted to pay off all my college and law school debt. I was blown away by the fact that I could earn in just a couple of months what it took my mother nearly a whole year to earn. So I joined the firm and bought a new car, spent my Saturdays shoe shopping and dining out. But I lasted that firm only about 11 months. I knew almost immediately that I had taken a wrong turn and that the fire that had been lit within me while I was in law school would die, would be snuffed out if I stayed there a moment longer. And so I said goodbye. Now I mention all of this because when we talk about shaking the foundations, I think it's important for us to remind ourselves from time to time that the foundations that need to be shaken exist right where we are, in the institutions we currently inhabit. And our personal foundations need to be shaken over and over again. Even after 3 years immersing myself in social change dialogue, discussion, and research and writing in law school, and after losing countless nights of sleep organizing to save the Lawyering for Social Change program, holding protests we did, meeting with the deans, doing what we could to fight for an education that would help us to think critically and meaningfully about justice and our role as lawyers in this society. Even after all that, after just a few years, I was in my sausage casing, marching off to a corporate firm assigned to help some big bank do something or other to avoid regulation. But thankfully, the seeds had already been planted right here. And so I want to just take a minute to thank publicly those who helped to set me on my course. I want to call their names now, those who challenged me to think of my law school education as an opportunity for me to learn not about the law, but about the true meaning of justice, and who I could be as a lawyer, as a partner in efforts to do justice in communities and courtrooms and halls of power and in our relationships. All of the incredible, brilliant faculty members who developed that curriculum are now gone. They were denied tenure or permanent positions, or they resigned or left in protest. I had the honor of being taught and challenged by extraordinary thinkers and advocates like Professor Jerry Lopez, Mari Matsuda, Chuck Lawrence, Bill Hing, Kim Taylor Thompson, and Regina Austin. All of them brilliant, courageous, people of color who rocked my world. And I often think of the debates and discussions that I had in their classrooms, even now, more than 20 years later. I also want to thank Professor Barbara Babcock, who I hope is here tonight, who inspired me to work in a public defender's office while I was still in law school. I only had Barbara for one class, civil procedure. Not criminal procedure, civil procedure, but somehow she found a way to spend most of her classes talking about her years as a public defender. And by the end of that semester, I had learned a little something about Rule 36, but was mostly interested in defending the accused. So, thank you, Barbara. Those who are familiar with the student-led struggles and protests that birthed African-American studies departments on college campuses nationwide understand the critical importance of students leading the charge and demanding the type of education they need and deserve. And though we lost the fight for the Lawyering for Social Change curriculum, I could see coming back here with my own eyes and my discussions with the students that the spirit that gave birth to that curriculum is alive and well here at Stanford and manifesting itself in the form of the Shaking the Foundations Conference. So I'm grateful, truly grateful, that you've invited me back here to share with you the work that has now become the purpose and passion of my life, ending mass incarceration and the cyclical rebirth of caste-like systems in America. Given the protests in Ferguson last weekend and the news reported just this month that our nation's prison population is on the rise yet again, and the expansion of private detention centers for immigrant children and families, and the growing anxiety among poor and working class whites about the shifting demographics in America, there is no better, no more important time for us to be having this conversation than right now. For if slavery was our nation's original sin, it is the denial of race and its relevance to current structural inequality in a world dominated by global capitalism that is today creating a living hell for millions. As a nation, it seems we want to imagine that the days of racial caste and systems of structural inequality and oppression are just long gone. We want to believe that somehow racial inequality will end if we just stop talking about race, and if folks of color would just work hard and play by the rules. Just as the Microsoft CEO said just last week that the gender gap in pay in the tech world can be solved by women just staying quiet, trusting the system and hoping for good karma. We as a nation want to believe that if people of color would just stay quiet, play by the rules, and trust the system, good karma will come to them as well. But keeping quiet, playing by the rules, and hoping for good karma has never worked for those who hope to shake the foundations of any fundamentally unjust system. Just ask Rosa Parks, ask Ella Baker, ask Susan B. Anthony, ask Cesar Chavez, or Charles Hamilton Houston, or Anne Braden. Ask the countless numbers of people here in the United States or around the world, living or dead, who have ever sought to achieve truly transformational change and were not content to merely tinker with the existing machine. So I am glad that I'm in the presence of those who see value in shaking the foundations. But what does it mean, really, to shake the foundations in this moment in time, in this moment in our nation's history? I find that so often when we are faced with profound injustice, such as the murder of yet another unarmed black youth by the police, we fly into action, organizing protests or rallies or organizing conferences, or we find ourselves in an apoplectic state, posting to Facebook or tweeting various articles or working ourselves up into a sweat, running in different directions, and then what? Over the years, I have found that too often, even well-intentioned, well-meaning activists, in our rush to judgment, in our rush to speak or to take action and just do something about something, we skip that crucial, all-important step of asking the question, what is the truth? Not just the facts of who said what or what came first or later, not just the data and the statistics and the cost of this or that, not the debate about what the witnesses saw, or his arms raised all the way up or halfway down, did the police officer wait 3 seconds or 5 seconds before pulling the trigger? No, not any of that. What is the truth? The whole truth. What is the deeper truth, the truth that holds the power to transform, to awaken, to shake the foundations and allow something new and beautiful to burst forth? And so as as we think about Ferguson and as we think about the steady rise of our nation's system of mass incarceration, and as we think about the ways that race is being used as a wedge in immigration and dividing the poor and working people of this country, I think we should pause to ask, what is the whole truth, the deep meaning here? And then once we begin to glimpse that truth, it's not enough just to hold it in our minds and play around with it like an intellectual jigsaw puzzle. That's the danger of the academy. If we are to make our lives useful, if we are to be truly worthy of this magnificent gift of life, then I think we better get serious about sharing the fruits of the truth. So what is the truth about race and justice in America? I fear the truth is very painful, profoundly painful, so painful that we're likely to want to turn away, to change the subject, to change the channel, talk about something, anything else. The temptation can be nearly irresistible to deny the truth or to imagine that there isn't anything any one of us can really do and that everything is going to be okay if we just hold on or wait for the next news cycle to shift. Eventually, all of those images of the tear gas and the riot gear and the looting and the children with their arms raised saying, "Don't shoot, don't shoot," will just fade away. We just wait long enough, surely it all will pass. But here's the truth about the truth. It never goes away. It always comes back, resurfacing in new forms, sometimes masquerading in different guises, but always shows up again, daring us to face it. So will we face it? Will we face the truth? Speak the truth this time, in this age? Here's another truth about the truth. In every time and age, there are those who deny the truth, and those who courageously confront it and do their best to rise to the challenge this moment in history presents. I remember when I was a kid in grade school, I was so ashamed and demoralized whenever my teachers would talk about slavery or Jim Crow. The textbooks would show images of black people chained together in the bottom of slave ships, black people being hung from trees, lynched. I saw the whites-only signs and learned that people who looked like me had to sit at the back of the bus. My teacher said they wanted us to see these pictures so we could learn the truth about slavery and segregation, the horror of it all. But my teachers, as well-intentioned as they were, did not teach the whole truth. They taught about the pain and the suffering and the cruelty, the dehumanization, but they didn't say much about the courage, the resistance, the love that endured, the songs that were born in cotton fields, and the magnificent movements that were led by people who could barely read, could not even vote, people who were thought to be less than human. As Dr. Vincent Harding has eloquently written, there is a river of courage and love and rebellion and creative nonviolent action. A beautiful river runs through it all. And that's the truth, too. The question for us as we gather together at times like this is whether we are going to face the truth of our times and join that beautiful river, that raucous, sometimes dangerous river, or not. Are we willing to join that river, fully join the river, and help to widen it so it eventually engulfs us all, carrying us downstream to a place we all belong, or not? Now, I know some of us may not be ready to dive in right now. Maybe came to the conference thinking you may do some pro bono work one day, you know, but shaking the foundations, radical social change, maybe not. That's fine. You know, I played around for a long time on the riverbank myself, toying with ideas of justice. But my question is, are your toes even touching the water, really? And if they are you willing to take a few more steps in? I seriously doubt that I have the courage of Martin Luther King Jr. or Ella Baker or Bob Moses. I wish I did, but I doubt it. But when I ask myself if I could take one more step into that river, I find the answer is almost always yes. One more step. And that's what I'm asking all of us tonight. Let's take one more step into the river of truth, love, courage, and justice, the river that runs through it all. But like I said, we can't really join that river if we're running around in all different directions on that riverbank, caught up in one reform effort or another, not seeing the connections between the various campaigns and advocacy efforts that we're all engaged in. If we think of all of this work as separate, and all of these battles as somehow fundamentally be won or lost on their own terms, we're not in the river. Joining the river means facing the truth of our times and dedicating ourselves with a revolutionary, loving spirit to building a truly transformational movement, one that confronts the truth and seeks ultimately a broad-based awakening to the dignity and humanity of us all. So what is the truth of our times? Well, it's no secret that I believe that our systems of mass incarceration, as well as our systems of mass deportation, can be traced to the original sin of slavery and the many ways in which that horrific institution first used race as a wedge to divide our nation's poor along racial lines. There are, of course, those who will say that I shouldn't make this a race issue, that there are so many complicated reasons why our prison population exploded, or that President Obama has deported more immigrants than ever before in history. And of course, it's not only about race. Slavery was not only about race. In fact, slavery wasn't even primarily about race, it was about greed. For centuries, a relatively small number of people wanted to steal the labor of others to get rich. And so they transitioned from an unjust interracial labor system based on indentured servitude to an all-black system of slavery that was justified and rationalized by the alleged inferiority of black people. Slavery wasn't motivated by hate or animosity of black people, it was motivated by greed. If there had been a better, easier way to steal human labor in a nation that was founded on the ideals of liberty and equality, they would have done that. It wasn't that slave owners were morally opposed to the idea of treating white laborers unfairly or cruelly. They just couldn't enslave them. There was too much risk of rebellion. It was too difficult politically. Similarly, Jim Crow was not primarily about race. It was primarily the effort by a relative few to maintain economic and political power over many. That's a game that has been played since before the Bible was written. Employing race as a tool is just the modern strategy in a nation already divided along racial lines. With slavery, powerful ideas about race, as well as extreme racial divisions and power, wealth, opportunity, and even cultural standards of beauty were born. And those ideas and divisions remain alive and well to this day, even as most claim to be colorblind. These ideas have harmed people of all colors, even poor and working class whites, who again and again have found themselves supporting policies and practices that are aimed at black and brown folks, but actually end up keeping many of them trapped at the bottom. Ian Haney Lopez has written a very good book about modern iterations of this phenomenon called Dog Whistle Politics. I recommend it. So when we pause and we really think about it, the notion that after centuries of slavery in this country, followed by 100 years of legalized discrimination and then Jim Crow, we might suddenly erase these century-old habits of thinking and being and just be done with all of that, seems nearly absurd. Old habits die hard, and this very American habit of birthing and maintaining brutal systems of racial and social control is a tough, tough habit to break, especially when most Americans refuse to even acknowledge that the habit exists. It's like trying to persuade someone to quit smoking when they won't even acknowledge they've got a cigarette dangling from their mouth. Nowhere is the American habit of creating caste-like systems more obvious than in our criminal justice system. And the recent murder of Michael Brown by the police, a virtual public lynching, is but a potent reminder. Isabel Wilkerson, the author of The Warmth of Other Suns, a wonderful book exploring the journey of families from the South to the North in an effort to escape the old Jim Crow, she recently published an excellent essay in The Guardian pointing out the parallels between police violence today and lynchings of an era supposedly long gone. She writes, "Not terribly long ago, in a country that many people misremember if they knew it at all, a black person was killed in public every 4 days for often the most mundane of infractions, for taking a hog, making boastful remarks, for stealing 75 cents. For the most banal of missteps, the penalty could be an hours-long spectacle of torture and lynching. No trial, no jury, no judge, no appeal. now well into a new century, as a family in Ferguson, Missouri, buries yet another American teenager killed at the hands of authorities, the rate of police killings of Black Americans is nearly the same as the rate of lynchings in the early decades of the 20th century. Let me repeat that. In the era of Obama, the rate of police killings of Black Americans is nearly the same as the rate of lynchings in the Jim Crow era. About twice a week or every 3 or 4 days, an African American has been killed by a white police officer. This figure excludes, of course, people like Trayvon Martin, who was killed by a self-appointed neighborhood watchman, and Jordan Davis, who was killed by a white man for playing his music too loud. Those types of killings are not included in the statistics because those young men were killed by vigilantes, not the police. Isabel Wilkerson acknowledges that there are many differences between the violence of the past and what happens today, but she is quite right that we ignore the parallels at our own risk. Images and stereotypes built into American culture since the days of slavery have persisted to this day, mutating and changing form over time. As she puts it so plainly, quote, last century's beast and savage have become this century's gangbanger and thug, embedding a pre-written script for subconscious bias that primes many to accept what they were programmed to believe about Black Americans, whether they are aware of it or not. Last century's beast and savage has become this century's gangbanger and thug. Now it's easy, I think, for people to say, well, it's not right to compare something like mass incarceration or police violence today to Jim Crow because, after all, Black folks in the South were forced into slavery or Jim Crow. They had no choice. But today, in this new era, Black people can avoid jail mostly by not committing crimes. It's their choice. And what about Michael Brown? Well, if he and other Black men would just lose the bad attitude and be polite to police officers, they'd be alive too. Black folks would just act right, be nice, trust the system, and hope for good karma, all would be well. I didn't quite hold those views when I first became a civil rights lawyer. I didn't blame poor people as a group for being poor, getting themselves locked up. After all, when I was in law school, I was dreaming of being a public defender. But I subscribed instead to another equally misguided view. The popular, seemingly progressive view that the growing numbers of people in prison, especially Black men, could be explained largely by poverty, bad schools, and broken homes. It was my job, I thought, as a civil rights lawyer, simply to do what I could to remove barriers, lingering barriers to opportunity and employment and education, and then all that bad stuff going on in the criminal justice system would just fade away. Fix our schools. Eliminate employment discrimination, and prisons will just disappear. It never occurred to me that something like a new caste system had been born again in America, and that it would be impossible to fix our urban schools or provide meaningful opportunity to millions as long as there was a literal war, a drug war, being waged in poor communities of color. And a get tough mindset, a thoroughly punitive mindset, was sweeping over communities of color nationwide. When I entered law school and I was in the Lawyering for Social Change program, the explosion in our prison population had only just begun. We had an awareness that a counter-revolution was underway, a vicious backlash against the civil rights movement, but we tended to imagine that the fight over affirmative action was the main battleground. Largely unbeknownst to us, as we were wringing our hands over whether there were going to be 25 or 13 or 3 Black law students admitted to Stanford Law School each year, millions were being swept into prisons and jails and ushered into a permanent second-class status with scarcely any notice by the civil rights community. In light of all of this, I am always eager to admit that my own awakening did not happen overnight. There was a time when I strenuously resisted the very claims that I make in my book and the cause that I've now dedicated my life. I bought into the idea that we are overcoming, that we are on the right path, that we still have a long, long way to go. But if we keep plodding along, in the direction that had been blazed for us, we were going to make it to the promised land. It was hard for me and so many others to imagine that we as a nation had already taken a U-turn, and we're headed right back in so many ways to a place we said was long gone. Not everyone was fooled, though. The first time I encountered the idea that something like a caste system was being born again in America, I was rushing to catch the bus in Oakland, California, and a bright orange poster stapled to a telephone pole caught my eye. And on it, it said in large bold print, "The drug war is the new Jim Crow." And I remember scanning that poster for a few minutes and thinking to myself, well, yeah, the criminal justice system is racist in a lot of ways, but it doesn't help to make such absurd comparisons to Jim Crow. People just think you're crazy. And then I crossed the street, hopped on the bus, headed to my new job as director of the Racial Justice Project for the ACLU. It was really only after years of representing people with claims of racial profiling, investigating police brutality, investigating patterns of drug law enforcement in poor communities of color, and attempting to assist people who have been released from prison re-enter into a society that had never shown much use for them in the first place, that I had a series of experiences that began what I now call my awakening. I began to awaken to a racial reality that just seems so obvious to me now, that what seems odd in retrospect is that I could have been blind to it for so long. As I described in the introduction, what has changed since the collapse of Jim Crow has less to do with the basic structure of our society than the language we use to justify it. In the era of colorblindness, it is no longer socially permissible to use race explicitly as a justification for discrimination, exclusion, and social contempt. So we don't. Rather than rely on race, we use our criminal justice system to label people of color criminals and then engage in all the practices that we supposedly left behind. Today, it is perfectly legal to discriminate against criminals in nearly all the ways in which it was once legal to discriminate against African Americans. Once you're labeled a felon, the old forms of discrimination, employment discrimination, housing discrimination, denial of the right to vote, exclusion from jury service, suddenly legal. As a criminal, you have scarcely more rights and arguably less respect than a black man living in Alabama at the height of Jim Crow. We have not ended racial caste in America, we have merely redesigned it. But like I said, it took me a while to get to that place. I had a number of experiences that finally began to open my eyes, and one in particular I'll never forget. It involved a young African-American man who was about 19 years old who walked into my office at the ACLU one day and forever changed the way not only I viewed our criminal justice system, but how I viewed myself as a civil rights lawyer and advocate. At the time, we had launched already our DWB campaign, our Driving While Black or Brown campaign, statewide campaign against racial profiling, and we'd already sued the California Highway Patrol for racial profiling and their drug interdiction practices, but we were looking to sue some other police departments in California as well, police departments about which we'd received complaints of discriminatory practices and tactics by the police. And so we set up a hotline number for people to call if they believed they had been stopped or targeted by the police on the basis of race. We put this hotline number up on billboards in Oakland and San Jose and Sacramento and other communities around California, urging people to call the hotline if they believe they have been stopped or targeted by the police for no apparent reason other than race. And in fact, within the first few hours after we announced our hotline on the evening news, we received thousands of calls, and our system crashed temporarily. We had to expand our capacity to deal with the volume of calls we were receiving. So I was spending my afternoon one day interviewing one young black or brown man after another who had called the hotline to report discrimination by the police. And this young man comes walking to my office carrying a stack of papers about this thick. He had taken detailed notes of his encounters with the police over about a 9-month period of time in Oakland. He had incredibly detailed notes of every time he was stopped, every time he was frisked, every time his car was pulled over, what happened, was he made to get out, was he forced to lie spread eagle on the sidewalk, was his car searched. He had names of witnesses, who was on the street with him or riding in the car with him. He had, in many cases, badge numbers of officers. Just an incredible amount of documentation and detail regarding this pattern of stops, shocks he had been experiencing in his neighborhood, and the stories he was telling me were corroborated by other stories we had heard coming out of his neighborhood. And so I started to think, maybe he's the one. Maybe he's the dream plaintiff we've been looking for in the suit we were planning to file against the Oakland Police Department, alleging a pattern of discriminatory stops and searches. And so I start asking more questions, getting excited, thinking, I think maybe he's the one. And he's well-spoken, he's a good-looking young man. I'm thinking he'll be great with the media, the jury will love him. I'm getting excited, and then he says something that makes me pause. And I said, what did you just say? Did you just say you're a felon? Did you just say you're a drug felon? And he gets quiet for a minute, he's just staring down at the table. We had been screening people with criminal records. When people call our hotline number, we would send a form to them to fill out, asking them a bunch of questions about their experiences with the police, and one of them was, have you ever been convicted of a felony? We believed we couldn't possibly represent someone as a named plaintiff in a racial profiling suit if they had a felony record, because we knew that if we did, law enforcement and the media would be all over us saying, well, of course the police should be keeping their eye on him. He's a felon. He's a criminal. This isn't about race. This is about going after the criminals. And we knew that we would be at risk. We put someone with a felony record on the stand in front of the jury and exposing them to cross-examination about their prior criminal history, thus deflecting the jury's attention away from the police conduct and turning it into a mini trial about some young man's criminal past. And so we had been screening people with prior felony records, and this young man had not now checked the proverbial box. I'm looking at him saying, you felon? You're a felon? And he's quiet, he's looking down, and finally he looks at me and he says, yeah, I'm a felon, but let me tell you what happened to me. The police set me up. They framed me. They planted drugs on me and beat up me and my friend. He starts telling me this whole long story about how he was framed and entrapped by the police and crack had been planted on him and all this. And I'm just like, oh no. I'm sorry, we are not going to be able to represent you. And I try to explain to him why that's the case. I'm sorry. He's trying to give me more information, the names of those officers, the descriptions of what had happened, and who said what, and this. I am sorry, we are not going to be able to represent you. I'm sorry. And he says, I'm telling you I'm innocent. I didn't even have that stuff on me. I'm telling you I'm innocent. I just took the plea because I'm scared of doing the time. They told me that if I didn't take the plea, I could be facing 5 years, 10 years, 15 years or more. But if I just took the plea, I could just walk out with just felony probation. So I just took the plea. I was scared of doing the time, but I'm telling you I'm innocent. I said, I am sorry, but I cannot represent you. And then he became enraged. And he said, good luck finding one young black man in my neighborhood that they haven't gotten to yet. They've gotten to us all already. He says, what's to become of me? He says, you know I can't get a job anywhere because of my felony record, anywhere. What's to become of me? He said, where am I supposed to sleep? He says, do you know that public housing won't even take me in because of my felony record? He says, I have to sleep in my grandma's basement at night because nowhere else will take me in. How am I supposed to take care of myself? How am I supposed to feed myself as a man? So I can't even get food stamps, food, because of my drug felony. So good luck finding another young black man in my neighborhood who doesn't have a felony record. They got to us already. So I can't believe I trusted you. You're no better than the police. He got up, took all those notes that he had meticulously taken, just starts ripping them up into tiny little pieces, throws them in the air, walks out of my office saying, you're no better than the police. I can't believe I trusted you. Well, several months after that, I was doing public access TV, broadcasting live out of his neighborhood. We were organizing a huge demonstration, people urging them to go to Sacramento to protest Governor Davis's refusal to sign racial profiling legislation. And we were holding town hall meetings up and down the state and organizing buses, taking people to this big demonstration, and I was doing public access TV, broadcasting live from his neighborhood, urging people, get on the bus in a couple days and go to Sacramento for the demonstration. Well, the minute that show goes off the air, he comes bursting into the studio carrying this dirty potted plant, and he's emotional, practically on the verge of tears, and he comes rushing up to me and he thrusts this plant into my hand. And he says, I'm just here to tell you I'm sorry. Just here to tell you I'm sorry, since I've been seeing you on the news, I've been seeing you out there trying to fight for our people, trying to do the right thing, and I shouldn't have treated you like that. I shouldn't have spoken to you that way. So I would have bought you some flowers, but I still got no money. I snatched this plant from my grandma's front porch. Pushes in my arms. And then he turns around and runs out of the building. I go chasing after him, and he jumps into this broke-down car and disappears. Well, several months after that, I'm in my office, open up the newspaper, and what's on the front page? Well, it turns out that the Oakland Writers police scandal is broken. A gang of police officers, otherwise known as a drug task force, have been planting drugs on suspects, beating folks up, and who is named as one of the main officers charged with planting drugs on suspects and beating folks up? The officer he had identified to me as having planted drugs on him and beat up him and his friend. And I'm embarrassed to say it was only then that the light bulb finally started to go on for me. And I said to myself, he's right about me. I am no better than the police. The minute he said he was a felon, I just stopped listening. I couldn't even hear what he had to say. And that was the beginning of me asking myself a lot of hard questions about myself as a civil rights lawyer advocate. How am I actually replicating many of the very forms of discrimination and marginalization I'm supposedly fighting against? But I also started asking some questions about the system as a whole. Why was it really that we hadn't been able to find one young black man in his neighborhood without a criminal record? What was really going on? And that was the beginning of my journey of just doing an enormous amount of research, asking myself and others a lot of hard questions, and most importantly, listening more carefully to the stories of those cycling in and out of our criminal justice. And what I learned during that process was that my great crime wasn't in refusing to represent an innocent man. My great crime was in imagining that there was some path to racial or social justice that does not include those we view as guilty. And I learned some facts that blew my mind. I learned there are more African American adults today in prison or jail, on probation or parole, that were enslaved in 1850, a decade before the Civil War began. I learned that as of 2004, more black men have been disenfranchised than in 1870, the year the 15th Amendment was adopted, prohibiting laws that explicitly deny the right to vote on the basis of race. And of course, during the Jim Crow era, poll taxes and literacy tests operated to keep black folks from the polls. But today, felon disenfranchisement laws in many states accomplish what poll taxes and literacy tests ultimately did not. I learned that a black child born today has less of a chance of being raised by both parents than a black child born during slavery. And that a large part of that has to do with the mass incarceration of black men, which of course takes them out of homes and families at young ages. But what's worse is that by branding them criminals and felons at young ages, often before they're even old enough to vote, they're often rendered permanently unemployable in the legal job market for the most part, virtually guaranteeing that most will cycle in and out of prison, sometimes for the rest of their lives. In this way, mass incarceration has decimated black families to a degree comparable to slavery. And this isn't some phenomenon that affects just some small segment of the black community. To the contrary, in many large urban areas today, more than half of working-age African-American men now have criminal records and are thus subject to legalized discrimination for the rest of their lives. It was reported several years ago that in Chicago, nearly 80% of working-age African-American men now have criminal records and are thus subject to legalized discrimination for the rest of their lives in employment, housing, access to education, and basic public benefits. These men are part of a growing undercast, not class, caste, a group of people defined largely by race, relegated to a permanent second-class status by law. Now, I find that today when, you know, I tell people that I now believe that mass incarceration is like a new Jim Crow, operates much more like a system of racial and social control than a system of crime prevention and control. People react with their stockists belief. They say, oh, come on, get out of here with that. Don't you know about Barack Obama? Haven't you heard of Oprah Winfrey? There's no racial caste system in this country, and if black folks would just stop running around committing so many crimes, they wouldn't have to worry about being locked up and then stripped of their basic civil and human rights. But therein lies the greatest myth about mass incarceration, namely that it's been driven primarily by crime and crime rates. It's just not true. It's not true. Our prison population quintupled in a 30-year period of time. Quintupled, not doubled or tripled, quintupled in a 30-year period of time. But during that 30-year period of time, crime rates fluctuated. They went up, they went down, went back up again, went back down again. Today, as bad as crime rates are in some parts of the country, crime rates nationally are at historical lows. But incarceration rates consistently soar. Most criminologists and sociologists today will acknowledge that crime rates and incarceration rates in this country have moved independently of one another. Incarceration rates, especially black incarceration rates, have soared regardless of whether crime was going up or going down in any given community or the nation as a whole. Now, it is certainly true that in the 60s there was a major spike in crime. But that spike in crime can't even begin to explain the tidal wave of punitiveness that washed over poor communities of color. The reality is that spike in crime coincided with a backlash against the civil rights movement, a vicious backlash against the civil rights movement that occurred at precisely the same moment that many black communities were suffering from economic collapse. As I describe in some detail in the book, what we now think of as the rise of mass incarceration was born of the perfect storm. The devastating disappearance of work in urban areas due to deindustrialization and globalization, leaving hundreds of thousands of black workers unemployed almost overnight. And the shift in rhetoric from former segregationists who once called for segregation forever and began chanting law and order and get tough on them. This perfect storm has led to the birth of a penal system unprecedented in world history. It's a penal system unlike anything the world has ever seen. And it can't simply be explained by crime rates or misguided criminal justice interventions. What has transpired can only be fully understood by appreciating the racial dimensions, the way in which these social, racial, and political forces interacted within our particular racial history and current racialized climate. And nothing has contributed more to the emergence of this caste system than the war on drugs. It's difficult to overstate the contribution of the drug war. Drug convictions alone accounted for about 2/3 of the increase in the federal prison population, more than half of the increase in the state prison population between 1985 and 2000, the period of our prison system's most dramatic expansion. Drug convictions have increased more than 1,000% since the drug war began. To get a sense of how large a contribution the drug war has made to mass incarceration, think of it this way. There are more people in prisons and jails today just for drug offenses than were incarcerated for all reasons in 1980. Now, the reality is, of course, that most Americans violate drug laws in their lifetime, but the enemy in this war has been racially defined. Not by accident, this drug war has been waged almost exclusively in poor communities of color, even though studies have consistently shown now for decades, year after year, that contrary to popular belief, people of color are no more likely to use or sell illegal drugs than whites, or sell. In fact, much of the research indicates that white youth are more likely to engage in illegal drug dealing than black youth. But that's not what you would guess by taking a peek inside our nation's prisons and jails, which for decades have been overflowing with black and brown drug offenders. The disparities became so acute by the year 2000 that Human Rights Watch issued a report showing that in some states, African Americans constituted 80 to 90% of all drug offenders sent to prison, even though they were no more likely to be guilty of drug crime. I find that many people who see these racial disparities, the data, say, oh, you know, that's a shame. That's a shame. That's a problem, but we need to get tough on them. We need a war on them, because that's where the violent offenders can be found in those communities. That's where the drug kingpins can be found. But the reality is that this drug war has never been aimed primarily at rooting out the violent offenders or drug kingpins. Federal funding in this war has flowed to those state and local law enforcement agencies that have boosted the sheer volume of drug arrests. It's been a numbers game. Law enforcement agencies have been rewarded in cash through federal grants and drug forfeiture programs. But the sheer numbers of people who are stopped, searched, the property seized, or people arrested, and the results are predictable. People of color have been the primary targets. They've been arrested en masse for relatively minor, nonviolent drug offenses. In 2005, for example, 4 out of 5 drug arrests were for simple possession, only 1 out of 5 for sale. And during the 1990s, the period of the most dramatic expansion of the drug war, nearly 80% of the increase in drug arrests were for marijuana possession, a drug generally considered less harmful now than alcohol or tobacco, and at least as prevalent in middle-class white communities and on college campuses as it is in the hood. But by waging this war and unleashing the get-tough mentality, primarily in poor communities of color, manifesting in the form of harsh mandatory minimum sentences, mandatory life sentences for some crimes, and stripping people of basic rights upon release, we've managed to create a vast new racial undercast in an astonishingly short period of time. Now, where has the U.S. Supreme Court been in all of this? The supposed defender of discrete and insular minorities? Well, far from resisting the rise of mass incarceration, it has facilitated it at every turn, eviscerating Fourth Amendment protections against unreasonable searches and seizures, making it possible for people, police, to stop, frisk, search just about anyone, anywhere, as long as they get mythical consent. Supreme Court has made it now nearly impossible to challenge racial bias in our criminal justice system, closing the doors to claims of racial bias at every stage of the criminal justice process, from stops and searches to plea bargaining and sentencing. This way, the U.S. Supreme Court has effectively immunized the system of mass incarceration from judicial scrutiny for racial bias, much in the same way that it rallied to the defense of Jim Crow and slavery in its day. But of course, being swept into the system with little chance of challenging the legal process that brought you there is only just the beginning. Because once you're swept in, you are branded, you are stamped for life. The rest of your life, you've got to check that box on employment applications asking the dreaded question, have you ever been convicted of a felon? Knowing full well your application is headed straight for the trap. For the rest of your life, if you're trying to get access to public housing, you know you can be denied, you must check that box. Private landlords are free to discriminate against you based on prior criminal history as well. Public benefits, even food stamps may be off limits to you because of a drug offense, depending on what state you live in. What are people released from prison supposed to do? You're released, can't get a job, you're barred from housing, even food stamps may be off limits to you. Well, apparently what we expect them to do is to pay hundreds of thousands of dollars in fees, fines, court costs, accumulate back child support. And paying these fees and fines may be a condition of your probation or parole. And then get this, if you're one of the lucky few released from prison and you actually manage to get a job, up to 100% of your wages can be garnished to pay back all those fees, fines, court costs, accumulated back child support. 100%. What are people released from prison supposed to do? When you step back and view the system, how it operates practically from cradle to grave, young people stopped and searched at young ages, their backpacks searched as they're headed to the school bus, made to lie spread eagle in the street, finally picked up for something and branded at a young age, and then ushered into a caste-like system where mere survival is nearly impossible. You step back and say, what does this system seem designed to do? To keep our streets safe? Seems designed to send people right back to prison. which is what, in fact, the system does very, very well. The vast majority of people released from prison return within a few years, and the majority of those who return to some states do so in a matter of months because the challenges of mere survival on the outside are so immense. So what do we do as people who are committed to shaking the foundations, challenging systems of structural inequality and social injustice? What do we do? My own view is that nothing short of a major social movement has any hope of ending mass incarceration in America. If you're tempted to imagine that something less will do, consider this. If we were to return to the rates of incarceration that we had, you know, in the 1970s or early 80s before the drug war and the Get Tough movement really kicked off, we would have to release 4 out of 5 people who are in prison today. 4 out of 5. More than 1 million people currently employed by the criminal justice system would lose their jobs. Most new prison construction has occurred in predominantly white rural communities. Communities have been led to believe that their jobs, their economic support depends on prisons. Those prisons across America would have to close down. Private prison companies now listed on the New York Stock Exchange and doing quite well even in a time of economic recession, they would be forced into bankruptcy. This system is now so deeply rooted in our social, political, and economic structure, it's not going to just fade away. It's not going to just downsize out of sight without a major upheaval, a fairly radical shift in our public consciousness. I know that there's many people who say, oh, well, there's no hope of ending mass incarceration. We can downsize this bit, but there's no hope of ending mass incarceration in America. Just as many people in the South in the age of the old Jim Crow would shake their heads and say, oh, yeah, it's a shame, but that's just the way that it is. I find that so many people of all colors now view the millions of people cycling in and out of our criminal justice system as just an unfortunate but basically inalterable fact of American life. Well, I'm quite certain that Ella Baker and the many, many others who risked their lives to end earlier systems of racial and social control would not be so easily deterred. I believe we have got to pick up where they left off and do the hard work of movement building on behalf of poor people of all colors. In 1968, Dr. King told advocates that the time had come to transition from a civil rights movement to a human rights movement. Meaningful equality, he said, could not be achieved through civil rights alone. Basic human rights must be honored, the right to work, the right to housing, the right to quality education for all. Without basic human rights, he said, civil rights are an empty promise. So in honor of Dr. King and all those who labored to bring an end to the old Jim Crow, I hope we will commit ourselves to building a truly transformational movement to end mass incarceration, a human rights movement, a movement for education, not incarceration, a movement for jobs, not jails, a movement to end all those forms of legal discrimination that deny to people basic human rights to work, to shelter, to food. And what do we do to build this movement, build upon the wonderful work that is already being done in so many communities around this country? I think we've got to start by telling the truth, the whole truth. We've got to be willing to admit out loud that we as a nation have done it again. We've managed to rebirth a caste-like system in this country. And we've got to be willing to tell this truth in our communities, in our schools, our churches, our places of worship, so that a great awakening can begin. Because unlike the old Jim Crow, there are no signs alerting you to the existence of this new caste-like system. The whites only signs are gone. And if you are not directly impacted by this system, if you do not have someone, a loved one currently behind bars, if you have not been labeled a felon, if you do not know someone who is being held in an immigrant detention center, if this is not directly touching you, it is easy to go your whole life and have no idea of what is going on. So if we are going to build a movement to end the system, we have first got to be willing to tell the truth about it and make it visible and help people to see the way we have a habit of creating caste-like systems in America. But while this talk and this consciousness raising is important, it is not enough. We are also going to have to get to work. And that includes, in my view, building an underground railroad for people returning home from prison. People were trying to make a break for true freedom, meaningful freedom. We've got to be willing to open our schools, open our churches, open our homes, our community centers, to people returning home from prison and seeking help, finding employment, shelter, food. People who need open arms and some expression of love. But even that is not enough, for just as in the days of slavery, it wasn't enough to try to shuttle a few, one by one, to freedom, opening homes and providing safe passage, you also had to be willing to work for abolition. Well, today I believe we have got to be willing to work for abolition of this system of mass incarceration as a whole. And that means ending the drug war once and for all, ending it completely. We spent $1 trillion waging this drug war, more than $1 trillion, and yet rates of drug addiction and drug abuse remain largely unchanged. All we've managed to do is criminalize millions. We must end the war on immigrants and insist that all human beings are deserving of basic respect, dignity, and human rights, no matter how they got here, or where they came from, or what they may have done. And we must end all forms of discrimination against people labeled criminals. Discrimination that denies them basic human rights. And last but not least, we've got to shift from a purely punitive model, punitive approach to dealing with violence and violent crime in our communities, to a more restorative and rehabilitative approach, one that takes seriously the interests of the victim, the offender, and the community as a whole. We've got a lot of work to do. And if it sounds like too much, if it seems like it can't possibly all be done, I hope we'll keep in mind that all of this, this entire system of mass incarceration, rests upon one core belief. And it is the same core belief that sustained Jim Crow. It's the belief that some of us, are not worthy of genuine care, compassion, and concern. And when we effectively challenge that core belief, this whole system begins to fall like dominoes. A multiracial, multi-ethnic human rights movement must be born, one that takes seriously the dignity and humanity of all people. And it's got to be multiracial and multi-ethnic, because although this drug war may have been born with black folks in mind, it is harming people and communities of all colors. A white kid living in rural Nebraska who's getting a prison sentence for a drug offense is suffering because of a drug war created with black folks in mind. And we see the same yet tough racially divisive mentality that led to the drug war and the system of mass incarceration leading to another prison building boom today, this one aimed at suspected illegal immigrants. So we have got to be able to connect the dots and build a multiracial, multi-ethnic human rights movement on behalf of all of us. But before this movement can truly get underway, I believe a great awakening is required. We've got to awaken from our colorblind slumber to the realities of race in America. We've got to learn to embrace those labeled criminals, not necessarily all their behavior, but them, their humanness. Or it has been the refusal and failure to recognize the dignity and humanity of all people that has been the sturdy foundation of every caste system that has ever existed in the United States or anywhere else in the world. It's our task, I firmly believe, to end not just mass incarceration, not just mass deportation or the war on drugs, but to end this history and cycle of creating caste-like systems in America. Thank you so much for having me tonight.
Anthropology and Linguistics at Stanford University.
Not only is he director of the African and African American Studies Program, he is also the director of the Center for Race, Ethnicity, and Language, and director of the Institute for Diversity in the Arts. His research focuses on the relationships between language, race, and ethnicity, and youth culture, particularly hip-hop culture. And Dr. Aleem facilitated a hip-hop workshop earlier today, which I've heard fantastic, great reviews about. Dr. Aleem has written extensively on Black culture and language, most notably his most recent book, Articulate While Black, Barack Obama, Language, and Race in the U.S. He has also written for and appeared in various media outlets, including the New York Times, MSNBC, the BBC, NPR, and Rolling Stone. The African and African American Studies Program has been a major sponsor of tonight's event, and it's been an absolute pleasure working with them over the last couple of months. And we look forward to continuing the relationship between the program and the law school. And so with that, I'd like to turn it over to Professor Aleem.
Thank you so much, and it's likewise, and it's mutual, of course. So I won't waste a whole lot of time with preamble, because I know we have people here, lots of people here, who have just heard an amazing talk full of information and insight. So we're going to get right down to the questions. If I may begin, just to say that at African African American Studies, our focus for the 3 years that we're in right now is race, policing, and mass incarceration. So we're so very happy to host you and to co-host you at the law school. I'll begin by saying that the one thing we have to talk about tonight, maybe a little bit more, is, as you mentioned, Ferguson. And we're in a Ferguson moment right now. So Ferguson, October, it's on everybody's minds, but we've been in this moment. The ones that you do so brilliantly in your work is you make a theoretical and practical evidence-based argument for the direct through line between slavery, Jim Crow, and mass incarceration. So the fact that we haven't ended racial caste, we've merely redesigned it, has been huge and influential. That's the idea. When you think of the police shootings like Ferguson, and not just Michael Brown, but there have been a few others since Michael Brown, even right in the St. Louis area. And I'm so glad you mentioned the Isabel Wilkerson connection. Can you say a little bit more about that connection for you and why it impacted you? Because, I mean, speaking more broadly on understanding contemporary forms or contemporary technologies of racial oppression in light of historical racism.
Yes, thank you. And I want to apologize for going on over time in my talk. I have to usually warn people that there needs to be a hook once I get going on this. I need to be dragged off the stage. So I think it is really important, you know, speaking as an advocate, that we constantly connect the dots between these systems and show how they are manifesting in new forms over time, because it's not obvious. And, you know, one of the frustrations I find when I'm kind of watching the news about Ferguson and listening to people talk in the media and all of that is that it's actually fairly rare to hear people connecting first police violence to the larger system of mass incarceration. So people have a tendency to talk about what's happening in Ferguson as a problem of police violence, rather than recognizing that it's a manifestation and a reflection of a much larger system of violence and war that has been declared on communities of color, and that it is rooted in our racial history. And it's hard to do. I mean, I can speak from experience when I have they say you have 6 minutes, you know, you're gonna have 6 minutes on CNN to say something. It's like, wow, what am I gonna accomplish in 6 minutes? You can see it takes me a while to get a point across. You know, I think it's a real challenge for advocates, but I think that drawing those connections is essential.
I mean, the numbers are startling. When you mentioned that the number of Black Americans murdered by police, is it the same as or more than?
The rate of, you know, police killings of Black Americans today is about the same as the rate of lynchings of Black Americans and lynchings of her era. And there are differences, you know, and I mean, I think that's one thing I think is important for us to emphasize, is that it's not just the same as Jim Crow. There's differences, but, you know, just as Jim Crow was not exactly the same as slavery, it was radically different, you know. It's like, well, Jim Crow's nothing like slavery. How would you say Jim Crow's anything like slavery? But obviously there was a common thread running through those systems, and I think being able to identify the common thread that exists today is important.
Excellent. I will be asking just about one or two more questions, so if folks would like to begin lining up the microphones in either aisle, you should probably line up now if you're going to get your question in. And please, make your question a question. Just to ask something, to ask you to build on that a little bit more, something that has really troubled me is you talk about the way that this is sort of happening under the nation's consciousness, and though it's so out of dialogue is constructed.
Yeah, I think it's important, you know, my own book focuses almost entirely on the experiences of Black men, and I have to say that's because as I was in my work, the book really was inspired by my work at the ACLU and all of the folks, almost all of them, calling the hotline and that I was seeing having these incidents with police, particularly the being pulled over because you fit the profile, look like somebody who would be a drug courier, look like someone who would be a gangbanger, that kind of thing. It was Black men. But I think it's critically important that we don't leave out women from the discussion, and in many ways, I think that the experience of women in the system is, in many ways, more severe, more troubling, and more problematic for the future of the Black community as a whole, even than the experience of Black men, partly because our communities are already so fragile today because of the assault, the drug war, and what it has done, you know, for Black men in particular, that now when you see rising numbers of women being swept in through the drug war, it means waves of children going into foster care, waves of people who find themselves homeless and struggling to survive. And very often, women who are released from prison, their first priority is, how can I reconnect with my child? How can I win back custody? And in states like California, it can be extraordinarily difficult, because what do you need to prove in order to get your child back? That you have a stable job, that you have a place to live, the very things that you're barred from are the things you need in order to get your child back. And that experience of having your children ripped away from you and being unable, because of legal discrimination against you, to ever get them back is a dimension of this problem, in addition to much of the sexual abuse that occurs of women by law enforcement that, you know, I don't think has received the attention that it deserves.
And there's just one more, because we have people waiting on the line, but I wanted to ask you, you talked about when you first started seeing terms like New Jim Crow and how that seemed sensational and possibly doing more harm than good. I know that amongst people who have read your book and who sort of follow your work and who are with you almost to the core get stuck on prison abolition. I don't know if you've noticed that, but do people give you that same crazy look when you say prison abolition, or is there...
I used to give people crazy looks when they'd say prison abolition, because I go, well, what do we abolish prisons and then what, you know? And, you know, I think that for me, my own evolving views over time, that I now, you know, think it's not, of course we need to have a system of justice, and we need to have a system for removing some people from our community that pose a threat or have done harm. But I believe in ending prisons as we know them, as sites of dehumanization, of just created simply for the purpose of punishment and cruelty, of demeaning people. That is how prisons are designed today. Without any hope of restoration, transformation, or rehabilitation, putting people in literal cages, treating them often worse than animals, and dehumanizing them, that is a system that ought to be abolished. And I think of our system of mass incarceration as encompassing not just those people who are behind bars, and this is a point that I feel like I don't repeat enough. The system of mass incarceration isn't just those people who are behind bars, it's all those people who are on probation, who are on parole, who are under constant surveillance, as well as all those people who have criminal records and are locked out of the legal economy and struggle to survive. And that larger system of keeping people locked down, locked out, is a system that we should abolish. It doesn't mean that we will no longer have a system of justice or removing people who pose a threat. It's about reimagining what justice looks like.
That's excellent. And we have folks lined up, so we'll take the first question right here. Thank you.
As a black man from Memphis, Tennessee, thank you so much for everything.
Thank you.
Please keep up the good work. You recently made a post about a recent publication by Jennifer Everhart and Rebecca Eady about, like, if people are exposed to the statistics of racial disproportionate rates of people being incarcerated, how that could lead people to actually support things like three strikes laws and, like, want to, like, keep more people incarcerated. So as we're shaking the foundations, I was just wondering, and like, I am one of her students, but I will use whatever you say. There's no wrong answer. For, like, the mass people who are in this room, who, like, haven't read your book and generally don't read books, for those people who are being exposed to these statistics and just taking whatever reasoning they can from it, how would you suggest, and you don't have to have this figured out, but how would you suggest that we can reach them?
I think that's an excellent question, and I think Jennifer's doing phenomenal research and work. So I have no problem with the research or the results, and they don't startle me. It doesn't surprise me that when people are confronted with these kinds of statistics that they dig their heels in, and it reinforces their own, you know, pre-existing patterns of thought, habits of thought about why people, black people, find themselves in the conditions that they do. And so I would never advocate as a strategy simply listing statistics to people. And I don't think generally advocates do that. Sometimes, you can see, sometimes where people on TV or in audience will just simply rattle out statistics without any social or historical context, without at all trying to reach them, you know, through their own value systems as well. But I think there is a danger that I have seen in the civil rights community generally, where there's this kind of mantra of race just scares people. We'd be better off talking about the cost of prisons rather than the color of people who are in them. It just wigs white people out. You know, you can bring them on board a lot easier if you just don't talk about the race stuff. And I think when you're talking about winning short-term campaigns, you've got a ballot initiative and you've got 9 months to win it, and what are you going to say in order to win in September? Yeah, you know, it's hard to move public opinion, do anything truly transformational in a 9-month period of time with some commercials and sound bites. But on the other hand, I think we have got to be honest with ourselves that we are never going to break this habit of creating these caste-like systems until we as a nation reckon with the reality of our racial biases, unconscious as well as conscious, and the ways in which our habits of creating these systems are linked to our particular racial history. And I can think of no time in American history when white people wanted to hear about race. When did they? They didn't want to hear about it when, you know, they were marching in Montgomery. They didn't want to hear it in Selma. They didn't, and every time, you know, in the civil rights movement, that there were marches, it actually, you know, deepened resistance. It made people in the South angrier. It didn't actually just win them over overnight. In 9 months period of time, if you'd done a poll on whether white people were now persuaded that they should let black children go to school, nobody would say, oh, well, the polling shows this is working. You know, it wouldn't have worked out that way. I mean, challenging white privilege, questioning white privilege to white people is going to produce resistance. Not because there's something intrinsically, you know, evil about white people. It's what Frederick Douglass says. You know, power concedes nothing without a man. People do not like giving up privilege. They don't don't like having the privilege questioned, and they will quickly rationalize the reason why some people don't have what they got. And so I think as advocates, we cannot be scared off about telling difficult, challenging truths, but I think we also can't just pound the podium and scream racism. I mean, in my book, I actually hardly ever even use the word racism, because I feel for the most part, people just get confused by it. They immediately imagine you're thinking about hostility. They immediately think that you're talking about conscious bigotry and bias and say, no, actually, what we're talking about here is a system that is supported by both conscious and unconscious biases and stereotypes that have been ingrained into us and manifest all over again. So I think I'm a believer, really, in speaking from a place of love and calling on others to see the humanity and dignity of others and to question the habitual ways of thinking of certain populations. I think it's critically important for people who have been branded criminals and felons to speak and to be heard and for their stories to be told. You know, we hear from the police officers, we hear from politicians. How often on the news do you get to hear from people who spent time behind bars and who are telling their stories? And so I think we've got to humanize people, we've got to connect the dots with the history, and we've got to tell the truth and the statistics as well. And it will make some people mad and inspire some resistance. But we are never going to break this habit in America if we don't finally, ultimately have a bit of truth and reconciliation.
That's a real, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jeff Garrett. I'm a third year at Stanford Law School. So thank you for coming here. I really enjoyed your talk. So my question is, what specific strategies do you have for influencing the mindset of people who are unwilling to acknowledge that a lot of structural inequality is driven by race? So more specifically, it's one thing to influence the people who come to talks and discussions like this, but what about everyone else?
I think that's a great question. And I think that there's room for debate and disagreement with what I'm going to say. But I think that it's a bit of a mistake in thinking about movement building to leap ahead to think, how are we going to persuade, for example, the middle class white voter? Instead, think about, how do we build a shared sense of community and solidarity among those who are most impacted by this? How do we educate those who are the most harmed first? Before rushing out saying, oh, how are we going to influence the suburban voter, the swing voter, say, well, what about in the communities most impacted? What is their understanding of their experience? What do we have to learn from them? What can we share with them? How can we begin to have a dialogue so that we begin to build solidarity and power and capacity within the communities that are most affected? And then as we begin to grow in larger concentric circles, begin to think about the kinds of creative, nonviolent action which helps to dramatize the righteousness of our cause. And you know, I've been in conversations with a lot of different advocates around the country who are having, you know, really interesting talks about how do we do that today? What is the lunch counter today? What types of, you know, creative, nonviolent actions will help to illustrate, you know, the real evil of the system that exists? And for example, one idea that a group of formerly incarcerated people came up with in Los Angeles was that they wanted to organize people who have been arrested to demand their Sixth Amendment right to trial as a way of trying to crash the system as a whole. You know, because, you know, typically more than 90% of cases plea out. If even a small, relatively small percentage of people who would otherwise plea out began demanding trials, it would pretty much collapse the system. But many people who tried to do that, insisted on a right to trial, would be punished harshly. You know, they would wind up getting 10 years rather than 2 or 3, or would wind up getting 5 years rather than being able to walk for felony probation, or may even be slapped with a life sentence simply because they were insisting on taking their case to trial rather than accepting a plea bargain. And so it would mean some people would have to really sacrifice, put their lives on the line in order to crash the system and force, you know, a confrontation about this. But on the other hand, every movement is always required people who are going to be willing to take real sacrifices to dramatize the righteousness of their cause. And I do not think this is any different. I think those who think we're going to be able to just kind of tinker with the system and reform it away are deeply misguided, and that it is going to take a courageous movement that, you know, hopefully will begin by organizing the people most affected and working with them, and then beginning to think about how we reach and shift you know, the consciousness and perceptions of those who are less impacted.
Okay, thank you. My name is Bob Hoover. I'm the director of the David Lewis Community Reentry Center in East Palo Alto. And I lived and worked in East Palo Alto since 1959. And for those of you who don't know East Palo Alto, we are a community that Michelle was talking about, and we're 2.5 miles from here. And we've been living that nightmare ever since I've been there. And I want to just say one little thing and ask a question. You talked about the war on drugs. I was a member of SICK, one of the organizers in my work in East Palo Alto. Spoke to Tom Ackley, one of his last speeches in East Palo Alto in 1972. And he talked about the demise of the civil rights movement because Martin Luther King had been killed, Malcolm had been killed, and he was next on the list. And he was preparing to go to Africa. Gave a speech about the demise of the civil rights movement. At the end of the speech, someone in the audience asked him, well, what do you think is going to happen to us now? And these were his words verbatim. I think they want to flood our community with drugs, and we're going to eat ourselves up from the inside. 1972. By 1975, exactly what he predicted was happening. Every black community in this country was flooded by drugs. Where did they come from? They didn't come out of black communities. Where did they come from? So we have lived this nightmare, and I'm living it right now. If I'm working with men and women every single day that are facing the exact same things you were talking about. You have a felon on your record as a black man or a black woman, it is a life sentence. There is no such thing as paying your debt to society. And one of the things that troubles me in all the years that I've lived in East Palo Alto, we've had some great relationships with Stanford from time to time. So my question is, how do we engage people in this audience, in our community, if you are truly interested in helping to bring about justice and help people who are suffering under this intolerable system to somehow survive? How do we engage those people, whether it be the African American Studies Department, the Stanford Law School, the social studies classes? We've been invited twice on campus to talk about this, and I brought young men with me to these classes, but then we never been invited to a law class. All the classes, be it history or social studies. So how do we engage people to not just come to a conference or a meeting like this and listen to a wonderful speech of how you move?
I think it's a critically important question, and in many ways, you know, for a conference like this, it's the question, which is, you know, how can people here in an academic community on a campus like this, who care deeply about shaking the foundations and making a real contribution and responding, what can we do here? And I think that there are enormous opportunities to serve and to partner with folks in East Palo Alto and beyond. And you know, I really believe that hearing from people who have been directly impacted and meeting them and having the opportunity to work with them in partnership, again, not as I'm the lawyer, you're the client, and how am I going to help you, you're the victim, and I'm the one who has the resources and the power, but how are we going to work together and learn from each other in trying to raise consciousness, shift understanding, and transform our justice systems. And so I would hope very much that people in this room would seek you out in terms of, you know, thinking about how to get you and others in classrooms and working together in workshops, and also getting students involved in the community in a direct way, building the Underground Railroad and beginning to work for, you know, meaningful, transformative, you know, strategies and advocacy that make sense given the experience, the lived experiences of folks in your communities. I know that there are, you know, all kinds of different programs that have existed on other campuses, for example, Clean Slate Clinics and advocacy organizations, student-based advocacy organizations that have been founded that have formed partnerships, for example, at Howard University and Columbia and others, where student groups are partnering with community organizations to engage in a wide range of advocacy. And so I hope that here at Stanford, that kind of creative thinking will take place and that people will reach out to you.
And I hope someone from the Criminal Justice Committee, NAACP, and the BSU will reach out, because this is a focus for our students, so hopefully we can make those connections. Yes, Andy.
Hello. I'm a performing arts teacher, actually, in East Palo Alto as well, at a high school there. And I'm preparing to integrate parts of your book in my criminal justice unit, which is coming up next. And I'm wondering, when we do this unit, there's a great deal of intimate anger from students who have had these processes and these systems impact their lives and their families in very real and ongoing ways. Students in last year's unit who, you know, has that record as a 16-year-old, tried as an adult, can't find a job, can't stay in school because of it. And I'm wondering, other than focusing on using art as a tool to educate and interrupt these systems, and education and law as a tool to interrupt and educate about these systems, what would you say are some of the concrete ways students as 16 to 18-year-olds can concretely be working to interrupt these systems, to transform these systems right now, today, to channel that anger in the most productive way possible?
Well, I think there's actually a number of organizations that are involved in wrestling with precisely those questions. Like in Oakland, the Ella Baker Center for Human Rights has a great track record of youth organizing to close juvenile prisons, youth organizing to confront police brutality. And they've engaged in a wide range of strategies, from organizing school walkouts to organizing to support people who have charges pending, holding, you know, large town halls and hip hop rallies based around these kinds of things, using, you know, phones to videotape abusive police practices and sharing and documenting and tracking police activity. There's a lot of, I think, creative work that is being done among youth right now, and trying to figure out what is our role and how do we find our voice in this time. And so I would really encourage you to connect with some organizations that have really been focused on youth organizing in California, and try to partner young people with those groups that have some experience and may want to work with them or inspire them to form their own organizations and groups as well.
Okay, I believe we have time for at least one more question over here on this side.
Good evening. Thank you for coming and speaking with us today. I think, as we were all just said, we're very grateful for your perspective. My question goes to something that you mentioned in regard to private prisons. Given the proliferation of private prisons and how entrenched they are in terms of the amount of capital and money that's going into the private prison industry, and the profit motives of those businesses, how do we work to affect change in regard to something that's becoming a whole different kind of beast in the private prison system? And the fact that private prisons basically have an incentive to support law enforcement in a way that's kind of counteractive to everything that we're talking about here today.
Can we take the last two questions really quickly and group them all together in a global response? So you two over here, please. quickly.
Yeah, I had a question concerning the transformative change that you were talking about and in conjunction with your book. The main theme of your book, obviously, is the epicycles of this racial caste system that transformed throughout U.S. history, but a subsidiary theme is the cases where there was a real opportunity for multiracial coalitions to be formed, but they turned out to be more like confederacies with the Bacon Act and, you know, late 19th century populism and even the sort of neoliberalism Clinton administration. And so a lot of that was in response to when the going gets tough, it seems like people drop out. Our allies that we really need, people drop out, and how can we prevent that from happening in the future?
And the last one.
My question had more to do with the example you brought up with the young man that you had met in Oakland, and I had realized in thinking about it that the idea that even pushing for those who are guilty, you know, whether or not they're falsely charged, is very important. And that had me juxtaposing in my mind the case of Michael Brown versus Wanderer Myers. And with Michael Brown, very tragically, the answer is very clear-cut, you know, in the sense that it's very clear he was innocent. In the case of Wanderer Myers, whose innocence is quite a bit more complicated, the conversation, even with many of my more radical friends, ends with, well, sometimes, you know, if you're armed, you're still a criminal, you know, it doesn't matter. And I'm curious how, or if it's possible to push the conversation past that. First, within even, you know, those who call themselves radical, and past that in the mainstream. Thank you.
Those are three big questions. you know, first, with respect to private prisons, I think, I don't know where he went, there you are. I think you're absolutely right that in many respects it is a game changer to have a profit motive now built into the criminal justice system. And I don't spend a lot of time in my book or in my writing focusing on private prisons. I didn't initially, in part because I wanted people to understand that this system wasn't born of a profit motive. It was born out of a deliberate use of using racial, exploiting our racial divisions for political and economic gain. That's where it came from. But now that, you know, private interests have found that they can make a killing off of mass incarceration, as well as building these private detention centers for immigrants, now the system is more deeply entrenched than ever and is going to be more difficult to dismantle. One of the promising strategies, I think, have been that beginning to prop up are divestment campaigns. Just as kind of the divestment movement, you know, unfolded in South Africa, I think divestment campaigns that call on churches, educational institutions, you know, any institution you occupy, to divest from private prisons. I know that the United Methodist Church recently announced they were divesting from private prisons. You kind of think, well, why in the world would the United Methodist Church be invested in private prison? But the reality is that because private prisons are such good investments, that they are now routinely included in all kind of investment portfolios, and very often organizations don't even realize that their investment portfolio includes private prisons. And so calling on organizations, educational institutions, churches, any organization you're part of to say, you know, you check to see whether any dime, one penny, is going in support of private prisons, or, you know, banks that are bankrolling private prisons, divest from those banks, calling out any organization, entity that is in any way, you know, helping to fund and support the profit, you know, in profiting off of caging human beings. And I think not only can that help to, you know, weaken the financial base of the system itself, but I think it's a really powerful consciousness-raising tool. Having these kinds of campaigns going on in churches and on college campuses, saying we should not, you know, be supporting any privatization of this kind of misery. Ending private prisons won't end mass incarceration, but the work to end private prisons, I think, can be part of, you know, the movement to end mass incarceration for sure. And the question about building solidarity amongst allies so that we don't have, you know, individual groups peeling off or being kind of co-opted, you know, I think is really important one. I mean, you know, as I said in my remarks, I believe we really do have to go back kind of to the Poor People's Campaign that, you know, Dr. King and so many others were attempting to launch before he was assassinated. The vision of really building meaningful, durable alliances between poor and working people of all colors, as well as their allies, to work for economic justice and basic human rights, you know, I think is absolutely essential. And I know my own view is that in the civil rights community, we have not done as much as we could to really build and develop as allies poor and working class folks who themselves have been harmed by many of the systems that have harmed people of color as well, and to help people to see how all of our interests are fundamentally connected. And too often today in our politics, but also in advocacy strategies that have been pursued by the civil rights groups, there has been a tendency to reinforce those divisions rather than, you know, seeking ways to ensure that human rights framing is expansive and inclusive enough to ensure that all groups recognize their stake in the process. And, you know, as for kind of the guilty versus innocent problem, you know, again, you know, I may be placing too much faith in making the shift from kind of a civil rights paradigm to a human rights paradigm. But I think that as we begin to use human rights language and framing and discourse in our work, the distinction between are you guilty, did you do it or not, becomes less and less relevant. The question is, you know, the issue is every human being, no matter who they are, where they came from, or what they've done, is a human being worthy of some care, compassion, and concern. Does it mean that they, you know, shouldn't be held accountable for harm that they have caused? No, quite the contrary. Because we care so much about them and anyone else who has been harmed, we are going to make sure that the resolution is one that is in the best interest of all concerned. And we're going to care about the victims, we're going to care about the community as a whole, and we're going to keep caring about the offender as well as a human being, because we recognize their basic dignity and humanity. I think the civil rights paradigm, you know, in my own view, allows for, you know, much more of a focus on individual rights and who's guilty and innocent, and due process afforded until you're found guilty, and then once you're found guilty, well, then you can be written off. I think that by focusing on basic human rights and the dignity of all of us, no matter what, we'll have more hope of creating a justice system that values life regardless of the labels of guilt or innocence.
This note of care, compassion, and concern is core to this critical work and to this critical message. We could keep you here for another several hours, but we won't. But we just want to give one more round of applause for all of you.